Hi, I am 16 days out from my psilocybin journey. I thought I would be videotaping the 10 days before and then right after, but man, I didn't know. I didn't know what preparation was going to take from me, and that's why I only did two at 10 days and one day before, and you can see those elsewhere. And it's taken me this long to want to make another video. First of all, being in my early 60s, as I explained before, I did not factor in what a huge physical impact my journey might take on me. Now, some journeys are, they usually 4 to 6 hours. I had a 25 milligram psilocybin dose. I was asking how long it had been for the first time at 6.5 hours, and I had no idea that it had been 6.5 hours, and I could hardly believe it. And I was still a little trippy for a couple hours after that, but I got sent home basically. I had two amazing people supporting me through that process. One was a therapist, and one was my husband. And I would not want to do that without them. And I even think I needed them both. It was really helpful to me to have a man and a woman, and a woman who was with me, and a husband who was really with me. I guess he left the room twice for going to the bathroom when I was kind of calm. But the rest of the time, they were hearing the music that I was hearing, which was good because there were moments when I kind of came out from under my mask or opened my eyes and said, "Can you hear that?" And then they nodded, and that was reassuring to me. My assistant therapist did a really good job for me in that she kept, in the beginning when I was saying, "Okay, I feel my hands tingling and I feel this or that sensation," she would just say, "Good, good." I could hear her say that because I wasn't looking at her anymore. At that point, I had a mask on. But she helped me feel like it was okay. And I had written a bunch of statements for her to use with me to reassure me and help me. And that was a really good thing. And I'd also set intentions, and I'd gone over them a number of times. I also think that was a really good thing. At one point, I was able to ask her to read intentions, and she started to go down a list, and it was just like, stop. I can only do one at a time. But what was really cool about it is I could do one at a time, you know? And one of the intentions I had was to have the ability to defend my own heart with love. And I will describe probably the most beautiful event of all of it was seeing myself at about 10 years old on my knees, kind of in an upright position, like if you were going to pray. And my hands were just down on my legs. But around me, there was like this three-dimensional force, and it was clear. But there were like swirls, like if you had the streamers that people carry on a string sometime, just the streamer part in pastel colors. That's my alarm. And cancel, Siri. Siri, cancel. Alexa, quiet. Okay, it's really Alexa. Anyway, there were these swirls of color that went around me that were pastel, and it was all within like this sphere of clear force, but there was something you could see. I mean, it was like clear swirling force, and it was all around me, all around that girl. I was outside me looking at her. And it was beautiful and moving, But the thing that was really incredible about it is that I knew in that moment as I watched that that was love and that it was impenetrable. So that's a pretty good experience, right? I had a gamut of experience, and I kind of feel like I touched on so many things from my entire life that when I got done, I was like, would there be anything else? And also, who would ever want to do that multiple times? 15 days, 16 days later, I'm in a little bit different space where I might do it again, but not yet. I understood this experience to be something that would like move something that was stuck, and that afterwards my brain would keep working with what I've experienced, and that things would change over time, over months. And I would want to give it months before I ever went back to do that again. But I think I learned something so amazingly important in my life. I have struggled with depression and anxiety on and off since I was a kid, and I can remember different times that were very tough, very lonely. And now I understand that the things I've experienced were symptoms. They were not the problem. I am not a depressed person. I am not an anxious person. I am someone who was traumatized in my early life, and these have all been symptoms, and they're normal symptoms, and I'm normal. And to be able to switch focus on from the symptom to the actual source of the problem is huge. It's life-changing. I had told a couple people this might be a life-changing experience without it really explaining what I was doing, and I think it will have been. I've done a lot of work on conscious things from my adulthood, work like therapy kind of work. I did an amazing seminar called Focus 20 years ago. It was a life changer for me, but it was all more current. It was all relating to my life now or then, but not childhood. And all the pieces, I feel like a puzzle is starting to take shape in front of me. All the pieces are falling in, and understanding how I've been affected, how my children have been affected, how my parents were affected. And at one point in the journey, one of the toughest places for me was seeing my understanding of what happened with him and my mother and other family members, and being so angry at my father. And I'll have to check with somebody. I don't think this lasted very long, like a couple minutes, and I screamed. But I think that it shifted to, and what didn't he get? And one of the things I experienced, I knew he didn't get the love he needed when he was little. And one of the things that I saw in my experience too that I'll share with you that was super beautiful, and I hope you can imagine this for yourselves, because I think we all need it to some degree. I saw a cosmic nursery. And there were all these hanging soft cradles made out of pink velvet. And they were all the same, and they were hanging all over this room, and or not room, but space. And all the babies were getting all the love that they needed. All of them. Me, you, everybody. And there were all these little girls that were taking care of everybody. And the girls totally understood everything. They totally knew how to nurture and care. And it was amazing. And at one point I saw two. I'll tell you, my experience started in the womb. And I also experienced faces looking in at me in a cradle. And they were the faces that I never had. They were all these approving, your wonderful faces that at one point went back generations. My mother's deceased, but I saw her, but I saw her mother and all these other women from generations. And there is so much more I can share, and I will. But what I want to tell you is that you're not alone. You're not alone, and there's nothing wrong with you. Whatever has happened to you has shaped who you are today and why you feel the way you do. I also think I read a book 20 years ago called The Highly Sensitive Person, and I know that I am one of those people. And if you are too, then what you've experienced in any way, any kind of trauma, is only magnified because you're so sensitive. Again, there's nothing wrong with you. As a matter of fact, without our sensitive people, we wouldn't have some of the most creative, amazing, beautiful art that comes to us in many ways, whether it's song or dance or music or painting, sculpting, this incredible creative force that comes with that sensitivity. And so if that's you, please celebrate you because you are wonderful. You're not better than other people, but you're you, the way you were designed to be, and you're wonderful. I have heard too many times in my life, you're too sensitive. And I heard an analogy today. It's like telling someone, well, your eyes are too brown. Your eyes should be less brown. Really not helpful, right? Okay, so I did it, and I give myself credit for having a lot of courage because it was not something to do for the faint of heart. You know, if you go through a psilocybin journey, especially at the dose where I was, you're doing something big. And I want to tell you too, I was completely incapacitated. I could not take myself to the restroom. I could hardly tell if I needed to go to the restroom or not. I couldn't get a drink of water for myself. Someone was holding that water for me, and I'm like, is this right when I'm tipping it? I knew I wanted tissues so I could breathe because I cried sometimes. But I couldn't like just go get some tissues or something. I mean, it was stuck in my hand, and then I could do it. That was probably the thing I could do best is blow my nose. But you know, I've heard like I had been told beforehand that, you know, I could eat if I wanted to. If I got hungry, I could tell someone to go get me food, but there's no way I would have been eating during that. I think the dose was, I'm not going to say too high, but very high for me. And maybe too high. Maybe I'd go 5 milligrams less next time. But I wasn't really counting on that either. I mean, I didn't really understand what I could or couldn't do during a journey. Now I have a better feel. And I didn't like the incapacitated part. That isn't the greatest. But I also did journey preparation that told me to just go with it. Go with whatever I'm experiencing. Don't be afraid, you know, to just, or if I told myself if I'm afraid, I'm going to send love toward that. Like a shaman told my friend to do once. And on her journey, that is. And I decided that was a great plan. And actually, the good news too is that even though I was in dark places emotionally and physically during this journey, I was never really afraid. And I think part of that had to do with my prep beforehand. And part of it had to do with the things I had the therapist tell me, like, it's okay, be curious, go with it. And I did. I went with it. And that's good, because if you tried to fight the experience, you'd lose, and I don't think it'd be very fun. So I hope that's helpful and enlightening, and I do think I did a good thing, and I think that I'm going to be really dealing now with what's been underneath the depression and anxiety in my life and actually getting to the core of it. And that is really exciting. And I wish that for everyone out there who thinks there's something wrong with them. And most of us are a product of our experience and environment and our genetics. And there's nothing wrong with us. We're just human beings responding as any other human being in that situation might as well. So I'm wishing you love and grace for yourself and for others this day. And I'll talk to you soon. Bye.